standing alone without a dream in my heart, without a love of my own. Never had nothing, no one to care. That's why I seem to have more than my share. I've got a man crazy for me. He's funny that way. When I hurt his feelings once in a while, am I blue? Am I blue? Ain't these tears in my eyes telling you they say you have no lips for a fool such as I? They say you just believe in hello and goodbye. And they say that the one I admire isn't even remotely concerned, and that I'll go on playing with fire until I have learned my heart has been burned, they say. Mama may have, Papa may have, but God bless the child that's got his own, that's got his own. He just don't worry about nothing, 'cause he's got his own.
Mom and Pop were just a couple of kids when they got married. He was 18 and she was 16, and I was 3. Billie Holiday in the celebrated first lines of her autobiography, Lady Sings the Blues. The book describes candidly, and often with the glancing defiance of those first lines, the troubles Billie had seen since she was born in Baltimore on April 7, 1915, the daughter of Sadie Fagan and Clarence Holiday. He was a guitarist in the Fletcher Henderson Band. Billie Holiday's life story reads like something that even the most cruelly inventive Hollywood screenwriter could scarcely dredge up. She was kicked around unmercifully in her early childhood, and her father paid no attention to her whatsoever. She was raped at the age of 10 and went into prostitution a couple of years later. During her life, she experienced bitterly disappointing, often brutal love relationships, almost daily confrontation with racial bigotry, nightmarish bouts with drugs, dehumanizing government harassment, exploitation by promoters, and selfish demands of audiences who, in Billie's own words, often came to see her at concerts in the hopes of seeing her fall into the damn orchestra pit. It's not surprising that she could produce singing of such searing, gut-level quality.
My hours are slumberless, dear, it's the shadows I live with are numberless. Little white flowers will never awaken you, not where the black coach of sorrow has taken you. Angels have no thought of ever returning you. Would they be angry if I thought of joining you? Gloomy Sunday, with shadows I spend it. Let them not weep, let them know that I'm glad to go. Death is no dream, for in death I'm caressing you. With the last breath of my soul, I'll be blessing you. Gloomy Sunday.
Billie first became acquainted with jazz when the brothel keeper, for whom she ran errands for as a child, allowed her to hear recordings of Louis Armstrong and Bessie Smith on the Victrola in the front parlour. In 1929, when Billie was 14, she and her mother moved from Baltimore to New York. This was at the beginning of the Depression. Her mother was a housemaid and couldn't get work. Billie describes the period in her book. "One day we were so hungry we could scarcely breathe. I started out the door. It was cold as all hell. I walked down 7th Avenue, going into every joint I could find to try and get work. Finally, I got so desperate I stopped at the Log Cabin, a club run by Jerry Preston. I told him I wanted a drink. I didn't have a dime, but I ordered gin and gulped it down. It was my first drink. I didn't know gin from wine. I asked Preston for a job, told him I was a dancer. He said to dance. I tried it. He said I stunk. I told him I could sing. He said sing. Over in the corner was an old guy playing the piano. He struck up Travelin', and I sang. The customers stopped drinking. They turned around and watched. The pianist swung into Body and Soul. Geez, you should have seen those people. All of them started crying. Preston came over, shook his head, and said, 'Kid, you win.' That's how I got my start." Billie was soon offered singing engagement in Harlem's clubs, and at one of those, Monette Moore's Speakeasy, she was heard by the famous jazz critic John Hammond. He tried unsuccessfully to persuade Benny Goodman to sign her as a singer with his band. However, he was able to organise a recording session for Billie with Goodman, and she recalls that time in her autobiography. "Benny came up to get me and took me to the studio downtown. When we got there and I saw that big old microphone, it scared me half to death." They recorded two songs, "Riffin' the Scotch" and "Your Mother's Son-in-Law."
Right into the fire.
be a mighty social lion, sipping tea if you please. My mother's son-in-law ain't got the least desire to set the world on fire. Just wish you'd make it proper to call my old man Papa. You don't have to sing like that, so you can tell the world I said so. Can't you see you've got to be my mother's son-in-law?
From Billie's very first recording session in November 1933, it's a typical Benny Goodman performance, relegating Billie to the position of band vocalist, but it became obvious to all that she had both style and a sound all of her own, even though the singing itself was raw. After that, nearly 2 years were to pass before Billie did another session. She did, however, get an unexpected chance to appear briefly in a film with Duke Ellington in which she sang Big City Blues with astonishing maturity and looking stunningly beautiful. Around this time, pianist Teddy Wilson came to New York and made an enormous impact with his playing. He was eventually signed by Brunswick Records to revitalize the pop tunes of the day for the newly flourishing jukebox industry. The budget for these recording sessions was low, 6 or 7 musicians, no arranging costs, and a vocalist, Billie Holiday.
Thank you.
Teddy Wilson on piano and Benny Goodman among the musicians there. Billie made 12 or so recordings with Teddy Wilson. John Hammond says they didn't make her a star immediately because innovators were frowned upon in the 30s. But to quote him, they started a trend in records which was never to be wholly abandoned. Most of the tunes were current Tin Pan Alley products that hadn't quite made the grade, but a minority were older items held in some affection by jazzmen.
What little moonlight can do. Oh, what little moonlight can do to you. You're in love, your hearts are fluttering all day long. You only stutter cause your poor tongue just will not utter the words I love you. What little moonlight can do. Wait a while till little moonbeam comes peeping through. You'll get bold, you can't resist him, and all you'll say when you have kissed him is ooh, what a little moonlight can do.
Could sing anything, and her style was completely her own. Untrained, with no technical knowledge, she instinctively created beautiful and sophisticated musical effects. To quote the Encyclopedia Britannica, her diction was unique and her phrasing inimitable. In July 1936, she started recording under the credit line Billie Holiday and her orchestra. The only difference of any consequence was that she opened and closed the songs, leaving room in between for brief solos from her sidemen. The use of her name as leader meant as much to Billie as anything that had happened to her. She remained loyally grateful to Bernie Hannigan, the songwriter and musical director at CBS. She said, "He was the cause of me making my first records under my own name, not as anybody's damn vocalist, but as Billie Holiday, period."
If you wonder why I'm near you, even though I've been denied, I'm inclined to be a little on the sentimental side. I suppose I should forget you if I had an ounce of pride, but I guess I can't help being on the sentimental side. I should act gay, laugh it off and say farewell, say it just didn't wear well, but I'm not that way. I'm in hopes you'll think it over and perhaps be satisfied with a simple sort of person on the sentimental side.
Her recording sessions became almost legendary events during this period, always involving the cream of the musicians of the day, especially those featured with the bands of Ellington, Fletcher Henderson, Benny Goodman, Chick Webb, and Count Basie. Experts consider that Billie's work reached a peak during the years 1937 and 1938, when she recorded with Basie's sax player Lester Young. In the Illustrated Encyclopedia of Jazz, Brian Case says, "With Young, Billie established almost unbelievable rapport, he providing sublime intros and obbligatos, as well as solos of superlative quality, each complementing, enhancing every vocal line to perfection." And that's where we leave part one of the Billie Holiday story. Next week, we conclude God Bless the Child.